He's charging around $700 for killing, sometimes killing several times a week. Most of his teenage years, he's been a gang member. So I can only imagine what those eyes have seen. My name is Mads Nissen. I'm a documentary photographer based in Copenhagen. So this is the work about homophobia in Russia. The first images are from 2013, and then I just keep going back. Homophobia in Russia is happening on so many levels. It's happening within people themselves. It's happening in the families. It's happening in the street. What Putin is afraid of is that if you are a lesbian person and you talk about being lesbian to a child, suddenly that child will be a lesbian as well. So the law does not make it illegal to be gay, but it prohibits what they call gay propaganda to children. The consequence of this law is that you cannot show a rainbow flag to a child. The first image here is of Kirill. So right here, you have the police. On this side, you have some of the homophobes here. And in the middle, you have Kirill and his two friends. Kirill bleeding from his face because they're being punched at, they're being spit at, they're being kicked, all because Kirill is gay. What I like about the image is the way that his friend are embracing him. I like the stare of her eyes. I like that her lips are just slightly open. And what I find in this image is not just victims, it's also survivors. This is a very, very horrible image. It's actually a picture taken of a screen, and that's why you can see all of this here. This is Mashinkevich. He's a self-declared militant homophobe. Mashinkevich and his group put up a fake profile on a dating app. But when the person shows up, they catch the gay person, they drag him to somewhere, and they'll torture him for hours. They are pretending to cut off his head. They're interviewing him with this dildo. They're writing on him, shaving his head, painting rainbow colors. They film everything and share it online. And there's many other groups like this one in Russia. And some of them are even worse, where they rape the person, where they force them to drink their own urine to cure them from being gay. Those videos were made to encourage homophobia. But what I'm trying to do now with these frame grabs and putting it into this new context is directly the opposite. So I think this is the only funny picture I ever took. It's from another pride. You see all the balloons from the activist in rainbow colors. And in the foreground here, you see Russian policemen. If you look at the text on the back of them, in Russian you pronounce it Omon. But the joke here, of course, is that if you're looking at it through a mirror, it says homo, and they know. A few years ago, I did a story on maternity health in Nepal. And as part of this story, I was being given a tour by the director of the main hospital in Kathmandu. And he opened a small room, pointed at a chair where there was a small baby left alone. The girl did not have a name. The mother left her because the girl suffered from this illness where the liquid can go to the head, but it cannot leave. When I went to her and looked her in the eyes and smiled at her, she smiled back. So I printed the story and there was a lot of reactions. One of the reactions was from a businesswoman, Cecilia. Cecilia wanted to go to Nepal, pay for all the operation needed in order to save this little girl. She named her Victoria. They did a lot of exams. Despite her handicap, she had the functions of a normal child. The bond between Cecilia and Victoria became stronger and stronger. For the first time, there was someone who actually cared about her, someone to play with her. Here, Cecilia is using her mirror and her makeup to show Victoria her own face. As Cecilia explains, she's now probably the closest to a mother that Victoria ever had. So the plan is to put a small tube inside her head to drain out all the liquid. This is getting increasingly more and more complicated. Here she is, Victoria, in the operation theater just moments before the operation starts. Obviously, the little girl is scared, and you can see one of the nurses is trying to comfort her. But the operation actually went very well. More than 1.5 liters of liquid came out of her head. Things were getting better. It was almost like you could see the little girl was being relieved. But then there was hard days, moments where she seemed to disappear more and more. So this is where the story ends. Cecilia received a text message from the doctor in Nepal. She's back in Denmark, and it says something like this. Dear Cecilia, be brave. You tried, we all tried, but it was her fate. Try to find peace. The little girl did not make it. But as Cecilia says, at least someone cared for her the last days of her life. This project is called We Are Indestructible. It's about the Colombian conflict that's been going on for more than 50 years with the guerrilla group FARC and the government soldiers. And it's also a story about what is financing much of this, which is the cocaine production. More than 220,000 people have died in this conflict alone. This picture is of Andrea and David in a secret guerrilla camp inside the jungle. They are both members of the FARC guerrilla. It's a group that's been labeled as terrorists. And yet here we have a more intimate image of the two of them in the bed. I asked them, like, are you a couple? Andrea, she did like this. On the chest of David, said, no, we're not a couple. He's my lover. And and it shows a bit of that fierceness and that strength that you see in a lot of Colombian women. There's a lot of waiting time, so they're using the waiting time a little bit more interesting than most other soldiers. So this is the final stage of the cocaine production. So as you can see, Martin brought his wife, he brought his two children, and it's really just a family business. These people are not getting rich. It's the cartels who's getting rich. This is just ordinary farmers trying to make a living. They're really caught in the middle between the many armed groups. One thing that was a little bit concerning though was that Martin was also teaching his son how to make cocaine. And what you need to do when you're producing it is you need to taste it once in a while. And I remember that the son liked it a bit too much. So here we are in Cali, in one of the most poor neighborhoods. It's a gang-controlled area, and one of the gang is this one. This is John and Brian. They're robbing, they're stealing, but they also do murders for money, sicarios. Brian told me that he hates his job. He hates doing those kind of things, but he feels forced to do it because of poverty, because of no other options. One of the things that was so sad to me is also that whenever I revisited the area, some of them have been killed in the meantime. Whenever someone is taking cocaine here in Europe, in the United States, wherever in the world, made in Colombia, you're also financing the war. There's a trace of blood directly from the discotheque to these areas in Colombia. As I try to explain, the most important word for me in photography is empathy. I think that is the power of photography, that we can really use it as a tool, as a bridge to bring people closer to one another. So whenever I photograph hate, or war, or conflict, I'm looking for moments of hope, of love, of passion. And I hope the people who see the images also get inspired. Because if we're not inspired, nothing will ever change.